Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 1 Kings chapter 19. In our last lecture, Elijah, the prophet of prophets, showed us how to get things done. I mean, taking on Ahab, the king of the 10 northern tribes, and his princess or queen Jezebel, and the 450 prophets of Baal, and the 400 prophets of the groves, and he and the Lord showed them how to get it done. Well, today we're going to see kind of a weak side of Elijah, but I think there's a special lesson in what Elijah does in chapter 19 for God's elect, for what not to do if you are one of God's chosen. And again, we're going to see Elijah's weak side. Jezebel is going to find out what Elijah did to her 850 false prophets, and she's not going to be happy with Elijah. Let's ask that word of wisdom in Jesus' precious name, Father. We ask it, open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1, and it reads, "And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword." Now, these were prophets that ate at her table. In other words, she was providing them with food and no doubt shelter as well. So she was killing the prophets, the true prophets of the Lord. Elijah slew the false prophets. Now she wants revenge. We don't see any revelation on the part of Jezebel as a result of what I think she probably witnessed what went on at Carmel with the two offerings, but that didn't faze her. It may have fazed Ahab a little bit. We'll see when we get to chapter 20. I don't think it fazed Jezebel at all. 19:2. "Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, So let the God, small g, do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them," one of the 850 false prophets that he had slain, "by tomorrow about this time." Now, you see, the fact that Jezebel didn't see a revelation, and probably Ahab not so much, Elijah starts thinking, you know, I failed. God sent me to turn the hearts of the children of Israel back to him from Baal, and I failed. And he becomes somewhat despondent and weak. But this is what I want you to learn from this. As Jesus would say in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, "My strength is made perfect in weakness." Paul would say it very well in the New Testament as well. He would say, "When I am weak, then I am strong." Why? Because when he's at his weakest point, when we are at our weakest point, we should always remember that it's God's strength that we should rely on. And when we're weak and we turn it over to God, we pipe into his strength. And that's when we become really strong. But again, take from this a lesson from Elijah of how not to react to hard times. God didn't expect us to be hothouse lilies. But always remember, He will never leave you. He will never forsake you if you love and serve Him. Verse 3, and when he, this is Elijah, saw what Jezebel had threatened, he arose and went for his life. He's running for it. And came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. At this point, Elijah thinks that he's going to die. And his servant has been a good and faithful servant. He doesn't want his servant to die along beside him. So he's leaving his servant at Beersheba. Verse 4, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, the desert of Paran, and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die, and said, it is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers, meaning that I'm not better to live longer than my fathers did. And, you know, we all become weak at times, but take a lesson from this. When a little trouble comes our way, we sometimes feel like poor me babies, and we get on a pity party. Well, that's not what God expects, but that's sometimes what the flesh gives us. Take a lesson of what not to do in times of trouble from Elijah. You see, the day of Jacob's trouble, that's real trouble, is not that far in the distant future. Are you ready? Verse 5, and as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And this likely the angel of the Lord. In other words, the Lord himself. You see, and nowhere did God tell Elijah to do what he's doing now. God told Elijah to get down by the brook Kerith, and then Elijah obeyed. And then when the brook Kerith dried up, God told him to get to the widow of Zidon, and he obeyed. Then God told him to gather all the people together and going to do the sacrifice competition with the 850 prophets of Baal. Elijah obeyed. Here we've got Elijah kind of on his own trip. He's got his own agenda. The problem is he's more concerned about his own will than he is about God's will. And beloved, that's when you know you've arrived as a Christian, when you've matured as a Christian, is when God's will becomes more important than your own will. But we have the third miraculous feeding of Elijah in the Kings in this verse. First, you remember I mentioned the brook Kerith. The ravens fed him there. Then he went to the widow of Zidon. The widow fed him. And now the angel of the Lord feeding him. Verse 6. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake. This is Elijah, perhaps manna, bacon on the coals, and a cruse or a flask of water at his head, by his pillow, in other words. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. And note here, the angel of the Lord hasn't mentioned to Elijah where to go. And in fact, is the angel of the Lord is going to ask Elijah momentarily, what are you doing, Elijah? Something we need to ask ourselves occasionally. What are you doing to serve the Lord? Verse 7, and the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Now, the angel of the Lord has not told Elijah to go anywhere, but he knows where he's going, because he says, the journey is too great for you to go without sufficient energy. So eat and drink and rest. Verse 8. And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. And Horeb, a mountain range consisting of many mountains, one of those mountains being Sinai, where Moses received the Ten Commandments. It'd be about 180 miles trip for him. It would not have taken 40 days, although it took Israel 40 years under Moses' leadership to travel that distance from Sinai to the Promised Land because of the people's rebellion against the Lord. Verse 9, and he came thither unto a cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, what dost thou here, Elijah? And again, he's asking, what are you doing, Elijah? And again, Elijah is doing his own thing. He's not doing what God has instructed him. I think this is interesting that he came into a cave on Sinai. You remember the first time Moses saw the Lord, or the manifestation of the Lord in that burning bush, and he hid himself in the cleft of the mountain? That's a cave. And perhaps this is the same cave that Moses hid himself in, and when the Lord revealed himself to Moses. Verse 10, and he said, this is Elijah, to the Lord, I have been very jealous or zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, the scripture quoted in Romans chapter 11, verses 2 and 3, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Well, he's feeling awfully lonely here. And you know, God's elect are going to feel lonely when things start coming down as well. It's going to feel like the whole world is worshiping Antichrist. It states as much in the book of Revelation 13. But you see, there are 7,000 that have not bowed a knee to Baal. We're going to learn of in this lesson today. There are going to be 7,000 of us who will stand and will not run from Jezebel. We won't run from Baal. We won't run from the Antichrist. We're going to stand and do the will of God, because his will is what is important, not our own. Note, Elijah didn't say, I'm running from Jezebel because she threatened my life. He says, I am zealous for the Lord, and the people of Israel have forsaken thy covenant and thrown down your altars. Verse 11. And he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains, and break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. Earthquakes often used to symbolize God's wrath and judgment. You see, at this point, I think Elijah, in his own heart and mind, would like to see Israel destroyed, and because they would not return their hearts to the Lord. But some did. Remember in our last lecture, the people realized when that fire came down and consumed Elijah's sacrifice, they worshiped the Lord and their hearts were turned. But here we have Jezebel and Ahab refusing to return to the Lord. Therefore, Elijah, I think, again in his own heart would like to see Israel destroyed. The Lord showing Elijah and us, he certainly had the power to destroy Israel if that's what he had chosen to do. If he can cause a wind, the ruach in the Hebrew tongue, to rip the mountains apart and the rocks, break the rocks in pieces, and then cause an earthquake, he certainly has the power to destroy Israel. And you know, this should be increasing Elijah's faith, would it? Verse 12. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. Again, fire known symbolic of wrath and judgment of God. And after the fire, a still small voice, the sound of stillness. The Septuagint translate this a gentle breeze. Yahweh is going to be in the gentle breeze. And it was so when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle, much as Moses did in Exodus chapter 3, verse 6, and went out and stood in the entering in of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, What dost thou here, Elijah? Twice for emphasis. Are you doing your own will, Elijah, or are you doing God's will? Again, Elijah probably wanted God to destroy Israel for their idolatrous acts. But that wasn't God's will toward Israel. As it states in Exodus chapter 3, verses 4 through 6, God is merciful, he's gracious, he's long-suffering. It wasn't his will to destroy the nation of Israel. Verse 14, and he said, this is Elijah, again he repeats the same thing, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, zealous, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to make it, take it away. And, you know, he didn't ask God, what should I do? When you are in a position that you don't know what the Lord would have you do, ask. He'll show you. And we didn't see Elijah asking what he should do when Jezebel threatened his life. And that's what he should have done rather than out here running all over the desert and Horeb. And that's not where God wanted him to go. How do I know? Because he's getting ready to tell him where he wants him to go. And you know, I only am left. Again, we see that feeling of loneliness. But always remember that if you are on God's side, you're in the majority. You and God make a majority. I don't care how many you're going up against. Verse 15. And the Lord said unto him, Go return on thy way. This is better translated, go return to thy way, to the wilderness of Damascus. I wanted you to go to Syria, not Horeb or Sinai. And when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And that's the first thing God wants him to do, is anoint Hazael the king over Syria. You see, God doesn't want to destroy Israel. He wants to chastise them. And Hazael, the king of Syria, will be one to chastise the nation of Israel. Verse 16. And that's not all God wanted. God wanted Elijah and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, actually would have to be the grandson, possibly great-grandson of Nimshi, but remind you, there is no word in the Hebrew for grandson or grandfather or great-grandson. Shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel? Ahab is apparently on the way out. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. Now, the two former, Hazael, king of Syria, and Jehu, king of Israel, Elijah won't anoint them. It will actually be the third that he is to anoint, Elisha, who will anoint Hazael, king over Syria, and Jehu, king over Israel. And some prophets would say, well, you know, that's proof that the Bible was wrong. Well, you see, it's prophecy, and Elijah will pass along any prophecies to Elisha that need to be accomplished, and doesn't make a difference of who anoints as long as the anointing happens. Verse 17, and it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. And of course, Elisha, a prophet, and I couldn't help but think about the sword of Elisha would be the same two-edged sword that of Jesus Christ in Revelation chapter 1, verse 16. In other words, truth. And but this is saying Hazael is going to cause some chastisement. Jehu is going to cause some chastisement. And Elisha will bring chastisement. There is a time for vengeance, and that vengeance is coming. Verse 18, this is the Lord speaking. Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel. These are the same 7,000 spoken of in Romans chapter 11, verse 4. All the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which hath not kissed him. This kissed him is a figure of speech, meaning to worship him. They stood against Baal, just as the 7,000 of God's elect that he's reserved unto him that will not bow a knee to Antichrist. We will stand against him just as these 7,000 stood against Ahab and the priest of Baal. Verse 19, so he departed thence, Elijah did, and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him, and he with the 12th, and Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him, symbolic of passing the prophecy, the position of the prophet, the along to Elisha, call to the prophetic ministry. And did Elijah choose Elisha? No, the Lord said, go and anoint Elisha. Now, this, not that it really matters, but 12 yoke of oxen, that's 12 pairs of oxen, 24 oxen. And this is indicative that it's the family of Elisha was very wealthy. Elisha had plowed the earth with 12 pair of oxen. Now, spiritually, he would be plowing the field of the 12 tribes of Israel. Verse 20, and he left the oxen, this is Elisha, and ran after Elijah. No questions asked. And said, let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he, this being Elijah, said unto him, go back again, for what have I done to thee? I haven't put any restrictions or constraints that would prohibit you from going back and telling your mother and your father and your friends goodbye. Verse 21, and he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen, a pair of oxen, and slew them, and boiled their flesh with the instruments of the oxen, and gave unto the people, and they did eat. Then he arose and went after Elijah, and ministered or served unto him. Now, he threw a feast, in other words, a party, as he was leaving on his ministry of prophecy. And note here, he boiled the flesh with the instruments of the oxen. This is talking about the plow. Most of the plow at this time would have been made of wood. Only the tip of the plow, which would turn the soil, would be made of some different material. But he took the wood of the plow, no doubt the harnesses, and he burned them. In that we see finality. He knew that he would not be coming back to plow the earth again, and therefore we see that finality there. Chapter 20, and you know, Elisha would go on to, he requested a double portion of the Lord, meaning Elijah performed, I believe it was 7 miracles. Elisha would be granted that double portion and would perform 14 miracles. In chapter 20, we see Israel and Syria go to war. In fact, twice they will go to war. Israel is going to be chastised for their idolatry. Chapter 20, verse 1. And Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, gathered all his host, his armies, together. And there were 32 kings with him, probably vassal kings of nations that he had previously defeated, and horses and chariots. And he went up and besieged Samaria and warred against it. He invaded Samaria, the capital of the 10 tribes of the north of Israel. And Samaria, again, becomes synonymous with the title Israel, the 10 tribes. Verse 2. And he sent messengers to Ahab, king of Israel, into the city, and said unto him, Thus saith Ben-Hadad. Ben-Hadad, by the way, means son of Hadad, and it's the name of several Syrian kings. This one likely the son of the Ben-Hadad that we were introduced in chapter 15 at the time of Asa. Verse 3. Thy silver, this is what Ben-Hadad said to Ahab, thy silver and thy gold is mine, thy wives also and thy children, even the goodliest, are mine. And the goodliest meaning the better looking ones, all of them, in other words, are mine. Now let's think about, how would you react to that? That someone sending to you and saying, everything that you value in life is mine, your gold, your silver, your wives, and your children. Ahab thought only enough to buy peace. Verse 4, and the king of Israel answered and said, my lord, note the lowercase l, O king, according to thy saying, I am thine in all that I have. And again, what Ahab is going to do is try and buy Ben-Hadad off. He doesn't have any intentions of giving him all of his gold and all of his silver and all of his wives and all of his children. By the way, some people said that if he'd offered just to take Jezebel, Ahab probably would have accepted. But and young kids, I want you to learn something from this lesson as well. And that is, don't give in to bullies. And parents, I'm not teaching your children that they should become fighters. But I am trying to teach them that there's a time to stand up and to not be bullied. For example, if you youngsters, if you have someone who takes and threatens you to punch you in the nose, if you don't give them your lunch money, for example. Don't give them your lunch money. Stand up. Because we're going to learn from this that even if you give them your lunch money, they're not going to leave you alone. They're going to come back. They're never satisfied. They always want more and more and more. So, and if the bully is bigger than you are, then ask for some help from your friends. Because if he's taking your lunch money, you can bet he's taking other kids' lunch money too. So gang up on him and stand up to him or her, I guess would be to be not gender specific. Don't give in to bullies. They'll always be back for more. Verse 5. And the messengers came again and said, Thus speaketh Ben-Hadad, saying, Although I have sent unto thee, saying, Thou shalt deliver me thy silver and thy gold and thy wives and thy children. And this kind of loses it in the translation. What Ben-Hadad is saying here is, I'm not accepting the little bit of gold and the little bit of silver and a couple of your wives and a couple of your children. I meant all of your silver. I meant all of your gold. I meant all of your wives and all of your children. Not just what you thought would buy me off. Verse 6. Will Ahab get some backbone about him? Yet I will send my servants unto thee tomorrow about this time, Ben-Hadad continues to Ahab, and they shall search thine house, more like ramsack, and the houses of thy servants. And it shall be that whatsoever is pleasant in thine eyes, they shall put it in their hand and take it away. Whatever you value, they're going to forcibly take from you. Verse 7. Then the king of Israel called all the elders of the land and said, Mark, I pray you, and see how this man seeketh mischief. For he sent unto me for my wives and for my children and for my silver and for my gold, and I denied him not. I didn't refuse to pay him some of my gold and silver, a couple of my wives and a couple of my children. And all the elders and all the people said unto him, Hearken not unto him, nor consent. Stand up to Ben-Hadad. We have got your back. We'll stand up with you. Verse 9, and we'll stop for the day. Wherefore he said unto the messengers of Ben-Hadad, Tell my lord the king all that thou didst send for to thy servant at the first I will do. But this thing I may not do. And the messengers departed and brought him word again. In other words, Ahab saying, what I sent to you at first, some of my gold and silver, a couple of my wives and children, that I'll stick by. But when you say you want all of it, that I can't do. Well, how will Ben-Hadad respond to Ahab's refusal to give in? Well, don't miss our next lecture and we'll find out together. We got a short message. I'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
Genesis 1:46, the first six chapters in God's Word. The world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. Please don't ask, if you have a biblical question, feel free to call that number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's Word in a positive format. Throwing out negative about others by name serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the telephone number. You don't need a telephone. You don't need paper and pencil and a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you. I encourage you to make time each day to talk to Him, to tell Him that you love Him if you do, and always remember you can't con God. But we learn in Revelation chapter 4, verse 11, why God created us. He created you to give Him pleasure. And you might ask, well, how can I pleasure God? Well, you can pleasure Him by talking to Him. And it's just, He's just like a father that had two children. And one of the children, when they reached maturity age, took off and never bothered to send a birthday card, didn't come home for Christmas. The only time that his father heard from him was when he needed something, a loan of money or something. The other one sent birthday cards, came home once a month to visit, was always there at holidays, Thanksgiving, and Christmas. Which child would you think would get the blessings from the father? Of course, the one who communicates with his father, doesn't forget about him, because if you forget God, he will forget you. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, financial difficulties, addictions, Father. If it is your will, a special blessing on each of these. And we also remember our military troops are in harm's way around the world. Father, watch over, guide, direct, protect, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions and see what's on the mind of folks around the country. First up today, we have Sharon in Missouri. And Sharon says, in a recent newsletter, you said the creatures in Ezekiel 1:16 were all different. Ezekiel 1:16 in the scripture, it says they four had one likeness. Please explain. Well, their bodies had one likeness, but it's very specific there in not only Ezekiel, but in the book of Revelation as well, that their faces were different. They had four different faces. One was that of a lion representing the tribe of Judah. One was that of an ox representing Ephraim. One was of a man representing Reuben, and Dan the eagle. And I think that's very closely tied to, and we'll learn more about it someday, to Numbers chapter 2, where each of the tribes of Israel has a standard, a flag, if you will. And I mentioned the four faces there. The flag of Judah had a lion on it, Reuben, a man. And those four tribes were on the north, east, west, and south of the tabernacle when they encamped. And everything was organized around the temple of God, and it will be in the eternity as well. And you continue in Ezekiel 1:23, your comment said that they were flying level. What does that mean? Well, if you're flying in an airplane and you're flying level, that means that you're going straight. But if you're not flying level, that means that you're turning to the right or to the left. See, Ezekiel had never seen anything fly but a bird. And he was doing the best he could to describe these vehicles that not only the four creatures came to earth in, but the throne of God came to earth in. And he did a pretty good job for somebody who had only seen an ox cart. Was the high-tech thing that he'd ever seen. Clara in Kansas, please explain Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 1. And I don't know what you're not confusing about it. It says to hearken, and that means to listen. It's a Hebrew word, actually, that is shema. And it not only means to hear, but it means to hear intelligently or with understanding. But Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 1 says, hearken unto the statutes and judgments which I teach you to do them, that you may live and possess the promised land. And I don't know what you're having problem with the statutes and judgments. What's the difference between law, statutes, ordinances, and judgments? You need to know the difference. I would encourage you to order a 2-CD set that we have entitled The Law 30598. Because you see, part of the ordinances don't apply to us today. Which ones? Well, the blood ordinances, for example, don't apply to us today. The circumcision today is for both men and women, and it's a circumcision of the heart. The sacrifices, the animal sacrifices, were also part of the blood ordinances, and we certainly don't offer sacrificial animals to God after Christ was crucified on the cross. He became the sacrifice for one and all time. Milford in Arkansas. Where are the teachings of Islam in the Bible? You won't find the teachings of Islam in a King James Version Bible. Myrtle in Kentucky, where does it say in the Bible that Adam and Eve children had children by their brothers and sisters? Well, it doesn't, but it only makes sense that if you have one couple of a race and you want to keep those races as you created them, as God created them, they had to marry or lie with their own brothers and sisters to prevent the races from being mixed. The laws of incest, I should say, were not given until the time of Moses. That probably being the reason. God said, go forth and be fruitful and multiply. Another question, the two Lazarus in the Bible, were they actual men that lived? Strong's Concordance number 2976 in the Greek dictionary says that one of the Lazarus was imaginary. Lazarus in the Greek is from the Hebrew word Eleazar. Eleazar, as you may or may not know, was the eldest surviving son. There was Nadab and Abihu, but God struck both of them dead. They were older than Eleazar, but after that, Eleazar became the son of Aaron, was very symbolic of the priesthood. The priesthood was supposed to remain, the high priesthood was supposed to remain in Eleazar's seed line. In Strong's opinion, and I'm sure because of the Lazarus listed in Luke 16, which is a parable, that the Lazarus there was spoken of hypothetically, and therefore he was imaginary. I don't think so. It was the teaching of Jesus Christ himself in Luke chapter 16, and I think the term there he was using, that Lazarus, I think he was used that name because the priesthood was dead and needed to be resurrected. Robert in Georgia, I think 1 Corinthians 2:9, and wonder what God might have in store for us. I know it will be more wonderful than we could ever imagine. And 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, for those of you who are not familiar with it, states, "Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither entered into the hearts or the minds of men the things that the Lord has prepared for those who love him." That was quoting Isaiah chapter 64, verse 4, almost verbatim. And yes, I, Robert, I agree with you. I think it will be walking around with our mouths wide open for the first 24 hours when we see it, maybe longer than that. David in Georgia, "I was writing you to find out if God will forgive me of an abomination. I feel in my heart that God will forgive me." And yes, David, it's impossible at this point in time that anybody has committed the unforgivable sin. And I don't know, you didn't say what abomination you did, but if you truly repent, that means a change of heart, that you don't want to do that anymore and you're going to do your best not to do that anymore, then God will forgive you. The unforgivable sin you can read about in Luke chapter 12, verse 10 and the following verses. It's for one of God's elect to refuse the Holy Spirit when they're delivered up before the Antichrist. Joan in Arkansas, "Please explain the New World Order and how close are we to this? The labor pangs are growing ever closer and closer for the beginning of a new age." The One World Order is the first beast listed in Revelation chapter 13. It's a political beast that receives a deadly wound, and that's when Pretty Boy Floyd, that's one of my pet names for the Antichrist, appears on earth. And we are being prepared, conditioned. When I say we, I mean the world is being conditioned to accept a one world order. Well, what do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, the United Nations, for example. You see the United Nations taking on police actions on behalf of the world in various nations. We have the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, who kind of controls what goes on in the financial world among the nations of the world. Even more recently than that, we've got the Eurozone, which is a common currency for all nations that belong to the Euro. We're being conditioned. Bill in Nebraska, "Why were the other people," and by that they mean the races created on the sixth day, "on earth condemned to death when they were not the ones who sinned in the garden?" Well, they were sinning, but you see, the law or the commandments had not been given to them. So when the law was given, it applied to them just as it applied to Adam and Eve. Romans chapter 6, verse 23 states, "The wages of sin is death, but until the law is given, there is no sin, no sin, no death." I think the ones who were created on the sixth day probably were lived to be longer than the ones who were created on the eighth day. We had the longest recorded living son of Adam was Methuselah. I believe it was 968 years old. I think we had members of the six-day creation that were over 2,000 years old, in that they were created by God. They did not die. Deborah in Oklahoma, where do we go when we sleep? And I think by sleep you mean when we die. That's a term used in the King James Version Bible to mean that when we die. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, which is the scripture that the rapturists point to, supporting their theory. But the actual meaning of what's going on in 1 Thessalonians 4, if you back up to verse 13, you learn that we don't want to be ignorant concerning them which are asleep. That means those who are dead. And we learn in the following verses that they are with the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. Paul does a very good job of teaching us that we have two bodies, a flesh body and a spiritual body, and to be absent from the flesh body is to be present with the Lord. And you know, God's word can be such a comfort to those who have lost a family member or a friend, that it makes people very vulnerable. And they start questioning their own, why are we here? Where are the dead? But you having the knowledge to tell them where their relatives that passed on are is an extreme comfort. And if you don't know and haven't studied it, I would highly recommend you order a CD that we offer here at the chapel called Where Are the Dead? It's CD number 30475. And if you have lost a family member or a friend and you don't know where they are, I suggest that you order that CD. It's on our list of suggested CDs for new students found on page 3 of every monthly newsletter. Alice in California, do you believe in life after death? Absolutely. You know, God's word promises everlasting life to those who believe on Jesus Christ, probably the most memorized verse in the Bible, John 3:16. Paul teaches us that we have two bodies in another location in Corinthians. I just mentioned 2 Corinthians chapter 5, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 35 in the following verses, Paul teaches us that we have a terrestrial body, a flesh body, and a celestial body, a spiritual body. Bobby in Kentucky, where in the Bible does it say, seek the Lord and you will find him? Many, many places, Bobby. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 29 states that if you seek the Lord, you will find him. One of my favorite places is when David was giving final instructions to his son Solomon just before David died, and as Solomon was taking the reins of the nation. He told Solomon, you know, seek the Lord and you will find him, but if you forsake him, he will cast you off forever. Everett in Idaho, as far as I know, when we die, our spirit goes to heaven. That's correct. And when Christ comes back, he will bring us back with him, and we will resurrect from the graves. Where do you get your information, and will you explain in depth, please? You see, Everett, what you said doesn't add up at all. If when we die, we go to heaven and we're with the Lord, and then an army is going to return with him, you're right, Revelation chapter 19. But if you're with the Lord, how are you going to come up out of the grave? You see, that's not logical, and neither is the teaching that when Christ returns, everyone, the graves are going to open up and everyone is going to come forth. That's not the way it works at all. Your spirit resurrects when your flesh dies. Your flesh returns to the earth forever. And thank goodness, would you want to go through the eternity in a flesh body? A flesh body particularly that's been down in a hole in the ground for 300 years? Well, no, We have something much better. It's called our spiritual body. James in Indiana. My doctor has prescribed certain drugs to me for pain. Will Satan be able to use this against me when he comes? Well, don't worry about it. Follow your doctor's orders. You should always follow your doctor's orders. Never hurts to get a second opinion if you question your doctor's orders. But as long as you're employing him as your physician, follow his orders. You know, if God has something he wants you to do when Antichrist returns, he will provide whatever you need or eliminate the need. Deborah in Wisconsin. I have been studying with Shepherd's Chapel, my church, for years. As there are no physical elders here to request anointing and prayer over me, what should I do when physical health calls for so doing? I need to call for such request in my life. What should I do? Do it myself. And yes, there's absolutely nothing wrong with you anointing yourself. Take a small amount of olive oil on your finger, anoint your forehead, and in prayer, ask God for healing in prayer. I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying the Father's Word in depth. And you know what? When he looks down from heaven and he sees you studying the letter that he wrote to you, the Bible, it makes his day. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. One thing that's most important, though, and it's this, you stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you. Genesis 1:46, the first six chapters in God's Word. The world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
All right, bless your hearts. Good day to you. Arnold Murray here at the Shepherd's Chapel. We're ready to get back into our Father's Word. What's the subject? Tongues. You'll remember in the last lecture, we discovered that the tongue on Pentecost, the miracle of the presence of the Holy Spirit, wasn't that it was unknown or not understandable, but just the opposite, that you heard it in the dialect in which you were born. That is to say, your natural language that you grew